We are all set, but before we go ahead and start coding, I think it's best for you to learn about states and state machines first. When opening up and loading a game, the first thing you might notice is that our player is idling. This is what we call a state. In this example, the current player state is the idling state. If we were to move, let's say by pressing W, our player will start running. Running is yet another player state. We've simply changed or transitioned from the idling state to the running state by pressing a movement key. This gives us two states, idling and running. Both of these states are implemented as their own classes with their own logic. This means that the idling state doesn't care about what the running state does, but only that it shall transition to it whenever we press a movement key, like W. The running state is the one that takes care of giving the player some desired speed. However, that transition needs to somehow happen, and the current state logic needs to somehow run as well. That's what state machines are for. They hold the current state, a method to change that current state, and if the state isn't public, one or more methods to run its logic. This brings us to one of the state machine system advantages. Each state has its own logic. An example on why this is a good thing is a typical jumping and being grounded. Let's have an imaginary situation where our player is idling. Whenever we press on the space key, our player should jump. One common problem when doing this without state machines is that if we keep on pressing the space key, our player will keep on jumping. The common way of fixing this problem is by adding an isGrounded check. If when the player presses space, there is ground right underneath the player, then the player can jump. Otherwise, our player shouldn't be able to jump. While this is alright, not only are the idling logic and the jumping logic in the same script, the jump is also caring about whether we are grounded or not, while it should only care about adding an upwards force. However, let's take a look at the same example using states and state machines. In our idling state, we have the logic of transitioning to the jumping state whenever we press the space key. When we do so, the state machine changes the current state to the jumping state. In the jumping state, the only logic we have is to jump upwards. There is no logic telling us that we should jump whenever we press space. This simply means that our player won't keep jumping if we keep on pressing space. Of course, if we did want to double or triple jump, we will simply add a count of used jumps and add a new upwards force whenever we pressed space. Something to note as well is that we do not need to check whether the player is grounded or not. The reason for that is quite simple. Our player can only be idling when it is in the ground, as otherwise our player will be in another state like falling. One other big advantage is that it's quite easy to add, remove or change a state. With one or a few scripts, we will have multiple states tangled within each other, and it can be a bit of a mess to add or remove an existing state, at least if you end up having quite a lot of them. With state machines, we add a new one by creating a new class and add its own logic to that class. And we can change the state implementation by updating that isolated logic. To remove one, we simply remove the file, the state transitions and whatever code was necessary for that transition. This does, however, bring us to a disadvantage. Each state is its own file. If we end up having 200 states, we'll end up having 200 files. This can easily add up a lot of files, which makes it harder to keep things organized. However, it does sound better to me than having those 200 states in just a few files. Another disadvantage is that the player can only be in one state at a time. If we are moving, then we can't be shooting, for example. Or if we are shooting, then we can't be moving. The first fix you might think is to have the movement logic in the shooting state, so that you can shoot and move at the same time. This works, but shooting shouldn't really be related to moving as they are two complete different systems, although it's fine if you decide it to be that way. The actual fix though is quite simple, simply create two state machines. This means that you'll have a state machine for movement and a state machine for combat, which allows you to be in two states at the same time in case that's what you desire. As far as I know, we can't move while attacking in Genshin, so they either do it in the same state machine or disable the other one. One last disadvantage is that state classes do not inherit from the Mono Behavior class. This means that we cannot add them as components in our inspector, which also means that any variable we want to set in the inspector needs to be done through another script. An example of this would be having a player script that holds all of that data and then passes that data to the state machines and their states. Furthermore, because we need access to those variables, we'll either need to make them public or somehow reference them by passing in every single variable. To keep things as simple as possible, we'll be making each variable a public property, and alternate between private, omitted, and public setters. Now that we have an idea on what states and state machines are, let's take a look at what states our player will end up having for our base movement system. Our very first state will of course be the idling state. As we've seen before, it's a simple state where the player stands still. From the idling state, we can start moving. In Genshin Impact, this is the equivalent of three states: walking, running, and sprinting. The main difference between these states is the speed at what the player moves at. In Genshin Impact, however, we can't directly go from idling to sprinting, but instead need to go to dashing first. Dashing is a low time but faster movement speed state. When we stop movement in any of these four states, they will transition to three other states: light, medium, and hard stopping. These simply decelerate the player until it comes to a stop, then transitioning to the idling state. We have two last states, which are the jumping and light landing. Jumping is a simple upwards force, while light landing happens when the player falls from a small height. There are two other landing states that will be introduced with the gliding system, as we'll also introduce falling there, but for now this one suffices. These are all of the states we'll be needing for our base movement system. We, however, can go a bit further. Each one of these states can be part of a group. And by group, I basically mean inherit from a base class that groups common logic. This is what's called our Oracle State Machines. Much like state machines though, there are several ways you can use them. So if you ever watch another video, it's quite possible that they will have a different implementation than mine. But we'll go with the simplest of them all, which is state inheritance. To make things easier, we'll start grouping states from the bottom to the top. The first states we want to consider are walking, running, and sprinting. These states can be considered moving states, as they are states the player will be when moving. With that same logic, our light, medium, and hard stopping states can be considered stopping states. While there's only one of them right now, our light landing state can also be considered a landing state. All of our current states, besides the jumping state, are states that the player will be when he is on the ground. This means that we can group all of them into a grounded state. Following the same logic, our jumping state can be grouped into a state for when the player is in the air, which we'll be calling an airborne state. As we already know, the movement system is the base of the other three systems. The reason why is because gliding and swimming all use the same movement but with different settings. This means that we can group every existing state into a base state, to which we'll call movement state. This will simply take care of moving our player around. And this is how our state hierarchy will look like. As I've said before, each of these states will have to run their own logic. This means that every single one of them needs to have common methods that run that logic. Because of that, we'll be defining an interface that defines those methods and implement that interface into our base state. Because every other state will end up inheriting from our base state, they will be able to use those methods and also override them with their own logic. To create that interface, we'll go into Unity and create a new folder named scripts in the assets folder. Inside of this new folder, we'll create yet another one named state machine. Here we can now create a new C# script by right-clicking in the project window and going to create C# script. I'll name mine iState. Open it up and start by removing the default methods and the mono behavior inheritance as well. To make it an interface, simply swap the class keyword with interface instead. There are a few methods in state machines that people commonly use. The first two are a simple enter and exit methods. The logic in these methods is supposed to run whenever we transition from a state to another. Enter will run whenever this state becomes the current player state. Exit is the opposite and will run whenever this state becomes the previous player state. This is good for setting and resetting data whenever we enter or exit a state. Let's then define a method for each of these. To do that, simply type in public void enter and public void exit. Remember, we are only defining the methods here and not implementing them. If you did want an implementation, you will likely use an abstract class instead. It does seem that Unity 2021 does support C# 8, which supports default interface methods. But I'm not entirely sure what's the line between abstract classes and interfaces in that case. Regardless, we now have two method definitions. Of course, we can't really run any constantly ongoing logic with these two methods. For that logic, we often have three other methods. Handle input, which will allow us to run any logic regarding reading input. Update, which will allow us to run any non-physics related logic. And physics update, which will allow us to run our physics related logic. You are likely familiar with the update and physics update methods, which are the equivalent of the mono behavior update and fixed update methods. The only new one here is the handle input method, which is us simply separating it from the update method. We'll be adding a few more methods here as we need them, but these will work fine for now. That's our state interface done, so now we'll be creating our base state machine. We'll be using an abstract class. So, back into Unity, in the exact same folder, create a new C# script. I'll name it state machine. Open it up and remove the default methods and the mono behavior inheritance. To make this an abstract class, we simply need to type in abstract before the class keyword. We'll start by creating the variable that will hold the current state. To do that, type in protected iState current state. Note that this is the class that every state machine we create will inherit from, so we don't want the current player state, but the current state of the context we are getting it from. Protected is here to make it accessible in classes that inherit from this one. We now need a few things. The first one is a method that allows us to change the state machine current state for another state. The second one, because our current state variable isn't public, are methods that access the current state logic methods. If you don't understand why, don't worry, you'll do later. Simply put though, we'll need them so that we can call them from the mono behavior methods. Let's start with the first one by typing in public void change state. We'll pass in iState new state as a parameter. What we need to do here is quite simple. We'll start by calling in currentState.exit. This resets any data that needs to be reset before changing states. Then we set the current state to be the new state. When that's done, we call in currentState.enter. This will set any data that needs to be set on the new state. That's really all we need to change states. However, we currently have a problem. Because this will need to be called once to set initial state, our current state variable will be null. This of course means that our exit method won't be called as it will throw an error, as null does not contain an exit method. The simplest fix for that is to add an if statement checking if the current state is null, and if it isn't, we can then call in the exit method. C#, however, has an and operator, which is a null conditional operator. Its use is quite simple. Simply add a question mark right after the code that can return null. In this case, we add it right after the current state. Now, if current state returns null, C# will not call the exit method. Our enter method doesn't need it as our current state is set to the new state right before we call it. It will throw an error if you were to pass in a null new state, but you probably want to know if that is the case. That finishes up our change state method. We shall now create a method for each of our state logic methods. To do that, start by typing in public void handle input. And inside, call in current state question mark dot handle input. That's all we need to do, so duplicate this method twice and swap the name with update and physics update. We now have a way to call the current state logic from a mono behavior class, so our base state machine is done.